Yeah, so I just did a video on 10 of the things that I wish I would have known when I started homeschooling. And that was more of a walk down memory lane and more of like a heart to heart. But I wanted to also take time to just give 10 practical tips for new homeschoolers, because this is a question I get all the time. It's my first year homeschooling. What are your best tips? And so I wanted to separate the more sentimental, emotional thoughts from the practical tips, because I hear you loud and clear. You guys want practical advice, and I don't do that often, so I'm gonna go ahead and do that today. So today I'm sharing my top 10 tips for new homeschoolers. So right off the bat, I wanna make sure to mention that obviously I am not in charge of your homeschool. These tips will have a personal bias, because these are based on my experience homeschooling my 4 kids. So I hope you guys can relate to most of these, but if something feels off for you, don't take my advice. You don't have to. Like I said in my last video, you don't have to keep up with the Joneses when it comes to homeschooling. You don't have to make another tip or another homeschool or another way of life fit your personal lifestyle. So just keep that in mind as I share these tips. Like if I say, for example, like it's really great to get a morning start, but you know for sure that that would be a terrible idea for you because you are just not a morning person or your kids are not morning people, then don't take my advice. So like I said, there is a personal bias here, but in general, these are the 10 tips that I think would be most helpful or practical in a new homeschool. So tip number one, I just said it, wake up and take the time to get going in the morning. Or if you're not an early bird, then just prep the night before. But mostly just being prepared and having a little bit of time for yourself before you start the school day is a great way to get started. I have tried to fly by the seat of my pants. Sometimes I have to, sometimes that's just like circumstances said, I fell asleep early or I just overslept and you just have to go with it. But in general, if you can take time to be prepared, whether it be the night before or what I think is most practical, waking up early and having a good start to your day, if you can take that time, it makes the day go so much better. And 99.5% of the time, the reason that we have an off homeschooling day or that things just are getting stop and go is because I was unprepared. So personally, I would say wake up early and get the day off to the right start. Number two, this sounds really counterproductive, but take a break in your day and get outside. I live in South Florida. For us, the best time is in the morning, but wherever you live, whatever the situation is, like weather-wise, just make it a point to take some time out of your homeschool day to get outside. It's good for your mind. It's good for them to get moving. It's good for everyone to just have some time in nature. And like I said, it sounds counterproductive because you're like, well, you know, why would we stop in the middle of our lessons to go outside? We need to finish our lessons and then we can go outside. But it is just in my personal experience, really great for the health of everybody in the home. If you can stop and reset and get outside for a little bit, connect with nature, and then get back going with your homeschool, everyone comes back refreshed. Maybe they need a little snack or some water, but everyone comes back in ready to dive back in. They've gotten some energy out. You've kind of, for me, connecting with the outdoors is so good. I hate when I don't go outside all day until I like go to get the mail in the afternoon and then I feel the sun on my skin and I'm like, oh, I wished I would have gotten this like warm, cozy sun on my skin feeling earlier in the morning, because it feels really good and necessary. And so yeah, just taking some time in the morning to get outdoors, let your kids run wild, play, connect with nature, and reset for another bit of school is super healthy and just one of my top tips. Number three, this one stings a little. I know every time I say it, make wise screen choices for yourself and for your children. Again, most of the time the issue is with me. I get distracted by my phone. I get a phone call or a text message or an email, and then next thing I know, it's an hour and a half before we're starting school again. Make wise screen choices for yourself. Model those wise screen choices for your children. But also, if iPads or screens or tablets are an issue in your home, don't give them before school starts. I mean, don't even make that a temptation. I know like 9 times out of 10, you know, when screens are an issue in a home, it becomes a relational issue because then you're taking them, then there's conflict. Make wise screen choices. Only you know what wise screen choices look like in your home. For us personally, we don't really use screens whatsoever other than for math or reading eggs as a reward. But my kids are not like on iPads at all. They don't really do iPads at all in our house, but it's only because there have been some major sensory and personal issues caused by screens, and so we just chucked them in general. But like I said, that's personally why we made that decision. I know families who do great with regulating screen time. I know kids who respond so well to screens being a reward in the evenings, or families who function great with screens being something that are just given on the weekends, or, you know, used for quiet time. So only you know what a wise screen choice looks like, but I'll just say to take the time to evaluate that, to model that behavior for your kids, to really dig deep and see if screens are the cause of relationship tension, and to just tweak it to make it a wise decision for your home. Number four, you guys have probably heard this before, but I'm trying to speak as if you're brand new at this, and you know, you haven't heard these tips before, so I'm sorry if it's a little redundant. But number four, one of my top practical tips, is rhythm over schedule, rhythm or routine over schedule, and to have markers in your day that you can use to restart. So schedules, a lot of the time, can cause tension, conflict, frustration, especially if you like have schedules down to like a 15 minute here, 15 minute there situation. That's not usually beneficial for a healthy home. It looks good on paper, but it doesn't usually play out that well. So just have a good rhythm, a good routine that you guys stick to, maybe an order of subjects. Now, some people do block scheduling. Some people just go in order in general. Some people have this on Tuesdays, this on Thursdays. Whatever that looks like in your home, a rhythm or a routine is 9 times out of 10 probably going to be much better, much healthier. But then also, you will get thrown off of even just a simple routine, even if it's not scheduled down to the minute. So have moments in your day that are reset moments. So like I said earlier, we have a time every day that we get outside, and then whatever happened before we went outside doesn't matter. When we come back in, we always start fresh with XYZ. Or every day after breakfast, we do this. Or quiet time is at 2 p.m. and then we read. You know, just markers in your day that help you restart if you need a fresh start at some point. I've just found that those markers have given us the grace we need to just start fresh when we come up to that time of day. So rhythm over schedule and markers in that routine that help you if you need a little boost. Number five, balance the high notes and the low notes. So something I didn't recognize for a few years is that things seemed very calm for me, so I couldn't figure out why my kids were frustrated. I'm like, our home is quiet, we're reading this, we're reading that, I don't know why everyone's frustrated. Because for me, what a low note looks like, just reading a book to them, for them are high notes. They're being like taught and spoken to and instructed constantly. So for me, I had to step back and evaluate like, what are the high notes and low notes for my kids? So we take a lot of game breaks, play breaks, sensory kit breaks, Play-Doh breaks, building breaks, STEM breaks. We like to take breaks here and there between subjects just to have a little bit of a low note for the kids so that they are refreshed when it comes time to sit down and get instructed again. So with homeschooling, the thing that is often overlooked but is probably true almost every day for kids is that they're being taught in a one-on-one setting consistently all day long, and versus being in a classroom where there's maybe a 1-to-20 ratio, and it's not so, you know, if they finish their work, they can sit there or grab a book, versus with you, as soon as they finish, you move on to something new, and there's not a lot of low notes in that. So just look at your kid's schedule, look at your own personal schedule, and try to balance the high notes and the low notes for the day. If you do composer and artist and, you know, poet study, and you do things that are more of like an enriching thing, maybe space those things out throughout the day instead of having it just like slow, high, slow. You know what I mean? Just try to alternate subjects and learning styles and settings throughout the day so that it's a little bit more balanced for your kids. Number six is trust your gut on curriculum and co-ops. I really can't say much more than that. You know your kids best, and just trust your gut. Just trust your gut. Don't let somebody talk you into a co-op or a style of homeschooling if it's not for you. If you know in your heart and you feel it in your gut that it's not for your kids, trust your gut. Number seven, my next tip is delayed gratification can serve a homeschool really well. So I don't let my kids play with their toys in their room until we finish school for the day. Naturally, we get into a routine when they wake up in the morning that includes breakfast and morning chores and some reading. And so they are not, I'm not having to pull them from their toys to start school. School doesn't feel like a chore. There's no tension in the morning. And then naturally when they finish school, they wanna run off and play with their toys or go play in their rooms or finish writing the comic book they were writing with their siblings. That's what goes on in our house most of the time. And so just use the natural delayed gratification as a reward. You don't necessarily have to have like a reward system or a bribe your kids to finish their work if you have some good delayed gratification, natural positive consequences set up for your kids. So I finish school, I get to go play with my Legos. It's a win-win for everyone. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. You don't have to buy stuff to give them. It works out well. Delayed gratification has served our homeschool super well over the years. Number eight, incorporate home life into your homeschool so that it's not all on you. So we call our chores contributions, and there are two times throughout the day that we do our contributions. We have morning contributions and we have afternoon contributions. It is helpful for the functionality of our home for us to do that twice a day because there are different things that need to be done at different points throughout the day. One, so that we have a pleasant atmosphere when we start homeschooling, and two, so that there's a pleasant evening atmosphere for our family and also just tidying up from the day's worth of school and cooking and all that. So incorporating that into your home is not only good for them to be learning the life skills and to be just participating in your home functioning well, but also it saves you from having to do three times the amount of work on your own because you have to condense a normal household's day of tasks into like 3 or 4 hours after you're done homeschooling. So incorporating that into your homeschool in bits and pieces is, I think, just good for everybody. Number nine, recognize and identify the triggers that are frustrating to you. Take some time to work on those things because that is going to be a roadblock every single time. So if you're constantly hitting frustration when it comes to math, or you are constantly struggling with, like for me, it's like sensory overload, then recognize what those triggers are and address them so that it's not a daily battle, so that everybody has positive feelings about a homeschooling day. Sometimes subjects need to be set down for a few days so you can just focus on relationships so trust can be built and you can get back into it. Sometimes that's us with reading and math. Sometimes it's that the curriculum's wrong. Sometimes it's that it's the wrong time of day to be doing that. Sometimes it's just that you are looking at a messy counter and cannot like give the necessary relaxed feel to a lesson because you are tense 9 times out of 10. Again, it's my attitude that causes issues, but address what those triggers are and just take the time that's necessary to fix those things so that you can move on. Even if it means you set schoolwork down for a few days to fix something in you that's causing an issue, that time will come back tenfold once you address that issue. Trying to just power through and consistently hitting the same roadblock isn't really beneficial in the long term anyway. So take the time necessary to address and identify what those triggers are that cause frustration and cause tension in your homeschool, and just address them, just take care of them. Allow the Lord to refine you in the process. There is nobody I know who has homeschooled for years and years and years who hasn't had battles that have needed to be addressed internally and relationally. So just take the time necessary to do that, and it will come back tenfold as far as a peaceful home. And then my last tip, and I kind of shared this when I shared my atmosphere video recently, is just pick one new thing each year. Don't feel like you have to be starting out with poetry tea time and artist study and nature study and 1,000 hours outdoors and doing, a handcraft. Just pick one thing each year to focus on and learn to do well, incorporate it naturally into your home and build on that the next year. So if I, like one year I focused on reading aloud, the habit of reading aloud. I didn't do poetry tea time that year. It was something new to us, so I didn't do poetry tea time that year. We didn't really focus on nature study as heavily that year. I made my main focus reading aloud. What happened is that became a habit for our homeschool. And then the next year I was able to incorporate a more consistent nature study and build on top of the fact that we were already really good and had a really good habit of reading aloud. And you don't have to do everything perfectly. There is so much information out there. There are so many bright and shiny things. You do not have to do them all at once. Even if they all look really good for you and they look like a good fit for you, you don't have to take them all on at once. Most of us who are homeschooling have years and years and years that we get with our kids. Most of us are not starting to homeschool in the last 2 years that our kids are home with us. And so just take the time to start to do one thing well and then build on top of that in due time. Don't try to do it all at once. You'll overwhelm yourself and then it won't be a joyful experience for anybody. So those are my 10 practical tips for homeschoolers. If you didn't see my last video, it was the things I wish I knew when I started homeschooling. I would encourage you to go watch that video too. It's a little weird for me to just give practical advice without kind of the more personal side of things. So these videos are kind of married together. So I would encourage you to go watch that video. Let me know what some of your practical tips are in the comments down below and I will see you soon. Bye guys.